Good morning, church. I want to welcome you to this time of worship where we've been gathered together by the Spirit of God. We've come together knowing that there will be blessing, knowing that life is good. I want to welcome each and every one of you. And if you are visiting with us this morning, an extra special welcome to you. And if this is a first-time visit and you'd like to tell us who you are, there is a little card in your pew rack that you can fill out. And we'd love it if you could let us know who you are so that we have that opportunity to reach out and get to know one another. I've got a few announcements this morning, and my first one is to invite Dan Panichida to come forward.
Good morning. I'm coming to you this morning as chair of the Board of Trustees because undoubtedly you have seen the scaffolding that's been erected out front and are probably wondering what the heck is going on. Well, I'm going to give you a brief statement about what's going on there. We've been tasked with repointing the stonework of St. John's, and that means we are replacing in that particular section, which we're calling Phase A, the mortar between the stones because of weather and decades of that area particularly being beat up. The mortar is deteriorating and allowing rainwater to come into the building and causing internal damage. There are areas where the mortar still is but is decaying, and there are areas where it's totally missing. The company that's doing the work put up a drone to take pictures, and what we saw at ground level was bad, but once they showed us photos of the higher areas, it was much worse than we had thought. So they're going to be working on that. As I said, it's a Phase A because eventually the long-term project is to have the entire structure done. Once they've removed the mortar that they do, they will replace it, and then they will also seal the area with obviously with some materials that were not available decades ago, and hopefully it'll make it last a lot longer than it has. In the March Enlightener, there's a letter on the front cover describing the work and talking about the financial costs that are going to be incurred, and as you will see, it's a substantial amount. And we're going to have to work on ways of getting the finances to do the entire job. There's also some pictures on the second page that shows the damage that I'm talking about. If you have any immediate questions after the service today, I'll be downstairs and hopefully can answer some of your questions. And Mark Bruin, my predecessor on the Board of Trustees, will also be available to answer some of your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Beginning on Wednesday evening, we will be hosting a book study here during the season of Lent. It will begin this Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, March 1st, at 7 p.m., there's still room for you if you'd like to participate. And you can participate on Zoom, or you can join us in person. We'll be meeting here in the library. And we will be talking about a very thoughtful book by Diana Butler Bass. And the title is freeing Jesus. We have so many images of Jesus that sometimes they get confining. And this book really opens up our minds to explore Jesus in new ways. We do hope you'll join us. Following worship this morning, there will be fellowship downstairs. We hope you will join us. We love seeing you. We like to see the smiles, the laughter, and of course, you're going to like the food. We've all been, we all carry so much during the week. We carry worries, we carry experiences. We've had our share of struggles, no doubt. This is the time when we put that down, that we render ourselves open to God's Spirit, who has a word for us, who has a presence to be with us. And so now we come, joyful people of God, to worship.
I invite you to join me in our call to worship this morning. Lent calls us to journey this day and every day, following Jesus wherever he leads us. Lent calls us to journey. Lent calls us to worship together, to hear and tell the good news. Lent calls us to faithful living, to trust the one who gives us life.
Lent calls each of us to take up our cross, to trust the one who bears it with us.
Lent calls us to journey with God.
Thank you.
I invite you to join me as we together confess our sins by praying the prayer of confession. Let us pray. God, you are one that lovingly journeys with us through all of life, but we long to feel you especially close in the dark and unsettling unknowns of Lent, trusting that all the paths down which you lead us are indeed loving becomes much harder when the terrain begins to get rocky, unsteady, and takes us to places we would rather not venture. We confess that we are quick to say God is good when all is right in our world, but we fail to praise and to seek you when they are not. Forgive us, God. Reframe our view of what your loving, guiding hand might look like in our lives. Remind us that our journey does not have to be easy or comfortable to still be full of love. When the road ahead is clear and easy, may we turn to you in thanks. And when the way is foggy and full of obstacles and challenges, may we turn to you for help and for hope. Amen.
We remember that story of a young man who took his inheritance and left for a foreign land. This man who squandered his money and his life. And one day, he came to his senses and cried out to God. He ended up going back to his father, who warmly embraced him and welcomed him. Such it is for us as we confess our sins. We go to far-off places. We lose our way, and yet we are welcomed back. We are forgiven. God's grace abounds, and that is good news. Amen. Our first reading from Scripture comes from the very first book in the Bible, the book of Genesis. These are the Hebrew Scriptures, known as the Old Testament. I think you will find these words familiar. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. Our second reading comes from the Christian scriptures, the New Testament, from the Gospel according to Matthew. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of God for the people of God. Okay, I'd like to invite the children to come forward if they would. Yeah. Hey, you guys in the balcony, I can see you. Can you come down and help me out this morning? Come on down. It's going to be very easy. Come on up. We need more people. Okay, we're waiting for one more. Anybody feel especially young this morning? All right. So I have something in my bag. And let me dig it. Oh. Who's that? Oh yeah, Lucas. Hey, Lucas. This is your lucky day. Thanks for helping me out. So I have a favor to ask you. You know what these are? They're apples. Yes, Lucas, I want you to hold on to that apple, okay? Now there's Gwen and Carolyn, correct? So we're going to have you hold on to the apple. And what's your name?
William.
William. William, here's your apple, okay? All right, now here's what I'd like. Wait a minute. I need to go to my office, okay? And I forgot something. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to hold your apple. I don't want you to eat it. I don't want you to give it away, okay? You are in charge of this apple. Got it? Okay, I'll be right back.
Psst. Hey, have a seat, have a seat, have a seat, have a seat. So, here's the thing. Have a seat. Pastor Addy forgot to eat breakfast this morning. Okay, so I'm really hungry. My stomach's been growling all morning. I could really use something to eat. Do you think that maybe one of you might give me your apple? Oh, and before you think I'm gonna give it to you for free, I do have some money that I could possibly give you for that apple. But if anyone's willing, anyone willing? Man, tough crowd, not even for my money? All right, well, I guess my stomach will just keep growling over here.
So you wouldn't give it up for money. But what if I have a whole jar of candy? Lollipops, multiple flavors, a lot of chocolate, because that's the best flavor. Now, you know me. I wouldn't come over here unless I was serious. I will give you this entire thing of candy for the apple. Why not? You sure? You sure? I don't know. Okay. It's weird.
Hey, what's wait a minute. What are you doing here?
It was their idea. Nothing.
It was what? Their idea. Yeah.
The choir made me do it.
Don't worry about it.
Can you tell me what happened? I was in my office. I couldn't find what I was looking for. But what happened? They were trying to get your apples? What did they do? They tried to give you money? What else did they try?
Candy.
And you didn't go for it? You didn't sell the apple? You didn't take candy for the apple? Oh, wow. I'm impressed. I think everybody in this congregation is impressed. You know, we're going to hear about, and we already heard, a couple readings from the Bible about temptation. Now, I'm going to ask you this. Were you even a little bit tempted to take the money? No? You guys are good. You're solid. How about the candy? Was there a little bit of like, I'd rather have a lollipop than an apple? Okay. Are there times in your life... How about you, William?
No.
Okay. You're pretty impressive. Have you ever been tempted in your life, though? Maybe not today, but have you ever been tempted? What have you been tempted to do that you don't think you should have done?
Spend all the money at the arcade.
You spent all the money at the arcade. Yeah, no, that's a very common temptation. We've all been there. We've all done that. Any other temptations that you... Lucas, anything that you, that's tempted you? Books that you really want. Yeah, there are times when we want something, right? And we're willing to be, we're willing to not be our best selves, right? We're willing to not be our best selves when there's something we want. Well, this person named Satan was trying to give Jesus all these things because you know what Satan wanted? He wanted Jesus' power. He wanted Jesus' life. And Jesus said, I'm never going to give you my life. My life is God's. It's not yours. So that's the lesson that we're going to be
hearing Pastor Addy talk about today. So I really want to thank you for being a part of this. You're very, you're just incredibly strong people. I'm very impressed. So you get to keep the apple, okay? And I want us to come up and be in a circle, okay? Yeah. And should we make a circle? Yeah, let's do that. Can we hold hands? Can we hold on to the apple with one hand? This is really tricky. Yep. You want me to hold an apple? Yep, I'll give it back. Okay. Okay. Dear God, sometimes we're tempted to do things that we shouldn't. And we ask you to give us the strength to hold steady. And we ask it in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Take care.
I invite you to be with me in a spirit of prayer. Loving God, as we think about temptation and entering into this season of Lent, we pray that your word might be in the midst of mine, and that the word that we need for the living of this day and the traveling of this Lenten journey might fall upon ears and hearts and minds that are open to receive it. Amen. Just say no. A popular catchphrase in the 1980s during the U.S. government's renewed anti-drug initiative. Just Say No was a whole campaign, in fact, launched by Nancy Reagan, which encouraged children specifically, but all people, to reject experimenting with or using drugs by simply saying the word no. It's just that easy, right? Now, I suspect that if you talk to anyone with any sort of history of addiction or struggle of this nature, they would tell you that things are slightly more complicated than just saying no, a highly oversimplified answer to a deeply complex issue. We like to oversimplify things. We like to make catchphrases and initiatives that boil something very multidimensional or gray or messy or complex down to something black and white, something we can mindlessly say or slap on a bumper sticker or check off a list. I often wonder if we have oversimplified Lent. If we have oversimplified this season of facing and wrestling with all the temptations of being human to another Just Say No initiative. Over the last several years, I've begun to see and understand Lent and temptations, the struggles in my life, in our lives, in a different way. It used to be that I thought about these things in terms of self-denial. Just say no. Don't do this, don't eat that, and everything will be fine. It's really easy to get stuck in those if-then cycles, especially during Lent, when this whole idea of giving something up pervades our culture. If I do this, then I am good. If I do this, then I am bad. If I give this up, then I have won Lent. If I eat this entire sleeve of Thin Mints, then I have lost the Lent challenge. But the more complicated life gets, the more complicated my life got, the more I realized that it really wasn't that simple or easy. Just say no and self-denial are not enough. They don't take us to deeply spiritual places of walking closer with God, which is the purpose of Lent. It can become so easily all about the no, N-O, and not so much the no, K-N-O-W. Now, I don't mean I exchanged self-denial for self-indulgence and gave up an opportunity for discipline or examination altogether, but I am saying that I believe our lives, our walk of faith, our Lenten journey, they deserve and they demand more than just simply saying no to things. God offers us more. I suspect we've all had times and experiences in our lives when just say no did not apply. Perhaps it wasn't relevant because the issue or the struggle we were facing was not a yes or no kind of situation, kind of question. Or maybe there were times that the rules simply didn't cover or speak to the situation you were in. What then? Where do we turn? There have also likely been times when we did follow the rules, when we did the right thing, when we said no. Times when we were who we were supposed to be and did what we were supposed to do, and despite all of that, it still didn't work out the way we wanted or thought it would. Something was still amiss, still lacking. We have all had times where we played by the rules, followed the directions, and yet we felt a deep sense of that disintegration we talked about last week, where there's no sense of integrity or wholeness. Sure, we were compliant, but we were not necessarily authentic. We were not truly and fully integrated or transformed. Last week, Reverend Dale challenged us to ask ourselves if we have experienced that kind of disconnect between what's going on inside and what's going on outside. Our entrance into the season of Lent and our scripture passages for this morning invite us even deeper into those places of disconnect, those places of struggle, what we often think of as temptation. Not so much in terms of self-denial, as we often associate with Lent, but more in terms of self-awareness. Maybe in facing temptation, maybe in our striving for integrity and wholeness, there is an opportunity for more than just saying no. Maybe these situations offer us important learnings about ourselves and about God. I think we often hear today's Old Testament lesson from Genesis, Adam and Eve eating the forbidden fruit in the Garden of Eden, and today's gospel lesson, Jesus being tempted in the wilderness. We often hear these stories and we hold them in opposition to one another. Adam and Eve got it all wrong, and Jesus got it all right. Adam and Eve were bad, and Jesus was good. If only Adam and Eve would have just said no to the serpent like Jesus did to the devil. Now, it's not that that's necessarily wrong. I just think there is far more to glean from these stories. There are deeper threads to be found, ones that run through and connect these two stories. And I think the deepest connecting thread is one of self-awareness and one of God awareness. You see, when we move beyond the just say no place, the dualities of good and bad, right and wrong, we discover that both stories are about deep and transformative knowledge of self and of God. Think about Adam and Eve. They eat the forbidden fruit. And do you remember what happens after they eat? Their eyes are opened. Before they ate, they were seeing with closed eyes, a partial seeing, a kind of blindness. But there's something about eating that fruit that opened the eyes of Adam and Eve and gave them a new awareness that awakened them and brought them to a new level of consciousness. The narrative that surrounds this story is usually of falling into sin. But as one commentator that I read questions, I wonder if maybe they didn't fall into sin as much as they fell into consciousness. They saw themselves, the good, the bad, the ugly. They saw all of it. Life and their world just got a whole lot more complicated. But it also became alive with potential for more authenticity and beauty. Think about the times when that has happened for you, when there's been a new awareness, a new awakening, a new consciousness, and you see the world and yourself in a brand new way. Often, that new sense of awareness, those new learnings, that new eyes wide open feeling seems to follow some sort of stumbling, a mess up, a failure, a struggle, a turning away from God or a loved one or ourselves. With this new consciousness, we might see pain and shame, yes, but we can also see beauty and goodness. We can see things for what they really are. We can see places of wholeness and integrity and the places of brokenness and disintegration. And not just in the world around us, we also see it within ourselves. We see the truth and the reality about our lives. We see beyond the yes and the no, the if and the then, the good and the bad. And we understand ourselves to be a holy mixture of both. We see all of our contradictions, and that's when things get complicated. It is not enough to just say no. If we look beyond their failure to say no, we can see that the garden experience brought Adam and Eve to a deeper sense of self and the world and a deeper knowing of God. Now, by the same token, if we look beyond Jesus just saying no, we can see his wilderness experience as having brought him to a similar place. Immediately, before Jesus goes into the wilderness, he is baptized. While Jesus is standing in the baptismal waters, a voice from heaven speaks and says, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased." We heard those words spoken on Ash Wednesday as we were reminded of our own baptisms. Then Jesus is led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted. He goes to the wilderness having been told, having been reminded, that he is God's Son. He goes to the wilderness having heard that he is God's beloved one. He goes to the wilderness knowing that his Father is pleased with him. And all of that is said, it's a given, before Jesus ever faces that first temptation. Whether Jesus said yes or no to the temptations would not determine if he was God's Son, if he was God's beloved child, and if God was pleased with him. Those are not the consequences or rewards for passing the wilderness test, but they are the givens, the preconditions of all that tempts us. Grace always precedes us. So maybe Jesus' time in the wilderness wasn't so much about proving something or giving something up for God as much as it was about Jesus learning and experiencing something about himself, that he really is God's Son, that he really is God's beloved, and that God really is pleased with him. Maybe there was something Jesus needed to learn about himself so that he could come out of the wilderness knowing who he was, knowing to whom he belonged, and knowing his message for the world. That self-knowledge and God-knowledge that Jesus gained in the wilderness formed and shaped his public ministry of healing and teaching and preaching. And ultimately, I believe it gave him the courage and the faith to bear the cross that God called him to bear. Now, if the wilderness was a place of deep understanding of self and of God for Jesus, might it also be for us? And if the garden and their face-off with temptation was a place of self-awareness and God-awareness for Adam and Eve, might there be an opportunity for us as we face similar struggles? What if all of us took the next 40 days of Lent and we let go of the questions about good or bad, right or wrong, and whether or not we are enough? And what if we simply sought a deeper awareness of ourselves, of God moving in our midst? What if we simply prayed that our eyes and our hearts might be opened to the painful stuff, yes, but also to the beauty and to the opportunity that awaits? Self-awareness is such a gift. Not in a narrow, selfish, and egotistical way, but in a way that is deep and profound, that reveals our integrity, our truest and most authentic self, that makes us examine ourselves and face ourselves, not to make judgments or inflict punishment, but to seek healing and new life, an eye-opening that opens us even further for God to enter in. Now, if we choose this Lenten path of self-awareness and God-awareness, this journey of integration, then we will need to slow down, observe ourselves, be watchful and mindful, and ask some difficult questions. What are the painful and wounded places in me that cause me to act out in ways
that are not good for myself or others? What are my buttons that get so easily pushed, that cause me to react with words or actions that I really do not want to say or do? What are the ways in which I have contributed to the pain of the world? And how might I contribute more towards its healing? In what ways have I knowingly or through fear lived a life less than who God knows me to be? What are the patterns and habits that direct and control my life? In what ways am I living authentically? And in what ways am I kind of lost? There is no doubt in my mind that in the midst of our Lenten journey, and always, self-awareness will take us so much further than self-denial. Now, if giving something up for Lent is your thing, I'm not going to stop you. But I do want to encourage you to reflect and use it, not as a built-in diet plan, but as a tool for self-awareness. How did that withholding, that exercise, grow me and change the way I see and engage the world? What did it do for my relationship with God and myself and my neighbor? Did it make me more real, more loving, more authentic? Lent is meant to be so much more than a successful completion of a 40-day challenge. Lent is meant to be holy. What if we went through the season of Lent hearing the voice of God asking us each and every day, what are you learning about yourself and what do you need from me? That just might be the start of a holy Lent. It would be a Lent in which our eyes were open to the truths about ourselves, who we are and what we do, who God is and what God does. It would be a Lent in which, despite things done and left undone, eaten and left uneaten, we would discover, or rediscover, or maybe hear for the first time, that we too are God's beloved children with whom he is pleased. Maybe it would be a Lent in which we could let go of judgments and scorekeeping. Maybe it would be a Lent that would feed us, that would lead us to new and fuller life. What are you learning about yourself? And what do you need from God? Challenging questions to hold on to as we journey into and through this holy season. My prayer is that this Lent, for each and every one of us, becomes so much less about just saying no, and so much more about knowing, with every fiber of our being, that we do indeed belong to God. Messy, broken, complicated, so very human, beloved. Amen.
Thank you.
There is so much that we bring to God. We bring the good and the not so good. We bring the joys and the struggles. This morning, I want to share some deep joys. We've got a lot of folks who are celebrating birthdays, and I still love birthdays. We want to remember Caden Gilbert, who turned 16 years old on February 23rd. We want to celebrate Jim Letterock, who celebrated a birthday on February 23rd as well. Judy Letterock is celebrating her birthday today. Judy Johnston is celebrating or has celebrated a birthday. It was February 24th. I also want to share the concerns that at least we know about corporately. You all have concerns that we will lift up in prayer as well. But this morning in particular, we want to lift up Ukraine. This is a country that's been besieged, in some ways hanging on by threads. And we pray for the people of Ukraine, knowing how much sheer devastation they have faced over the last year. We pray for the people of Syria and Turkey, who underwent this horrific, life-altering series of earthquakes, thousands upon thousands dead. The rebuilding will take years, and long after the camera crews leave, these countries will need our prayers and our assistance. Now, you may have joys and concerns as well, so I want to take a moment to pause for you to offer those right now in your silence before we begin our corporate prayer. O gracious God, in the complexity of life, we find ourselves at times wondering about what is good and what is evil. Sometimes it's very clear, and sometimes everything is muddled. God, we live in a time when there is so much complexity, so much good and evil mixed up together, and we find ourselves wondering, trying to make sense of it all. Oh God, we experience fears and uncertainties. And at times we feel like we are ourselves in a wilderness. We don't know which way to go. We have feelings of fear, of confusion, of uncertainty. We think about climate change and what it will do to our planet. We wonder about our economy and the world's economy. We worry about war and threats and intimidations that nations wage against one another. And in the face of all these fears and uncertainties,
We like to latch on to things that will give us security. And honestly, God, some of those things are not secure at all. God, we pray this day that we might learn to hold on more dearly to you, to trust you in the midst of ambiguity. Sometimes, Almighty One, our eyes are opened, but our hearts are closed. Almighty God, sometimes our ears may be open, but our souls are aching. So help us as we seek to be faithful. On this day, gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of life and for the birthdays of Caden, of Jim, Judy Lederach, and Judy Johnston. We celebrate their lives and the gifts that you have given to them. And Almighty God, we also pray for the people of Ukraine. Continue to give them strength and perseverance and wisdom and tenacity as they face an encroaching power wanting to strip them of their freedom and dignity. O God, be with the people of Syria and Turkey as they still live in shock and dismay and disorientation. Bring healing, and may other nations continue to come and provide aid and solace. Almighty God, we pray for the violence that is everywhere, on city streets, in corrupt places, and we pray for peace, the peace that only you can give. And we pray it in the name of the Holy One, the Christ. Amen. We now offer our tithes, our offerings, and our lives to the God in whom we trust, the God of the universe, the God of all creation. We will now receive our offering.
Good and giving God, we thank you for these many gifts, and most especially for the hands and the hearts that offered them freely, and for the ability to share them with one another, with our community, and with our world. Take all that we have offered this day, take all of our gifts, and use them in ways that are transformative. Grant us discernment and wisdom as we use these gifts,
that we might truly reflect you in all that we do and in all that we are. All of these things we pray in Christ's name. Amen. As our time together this morning ends, but as our Lenten journey just begins, I invite you to think about how God is calling you to focus on the know, K-N-O-W, to go even deeper in self-awareness and God-awareness in the midst of these days. And then, before you leave this space, take time to greet one another. Share the peace of Christ that is ours with one another. Let someone know you are glad they are here. Head downstairs to fellowship to continue to do just that. And then as you go from this place, may you know that the love of God does indeed surround you. The love of Christ fills you, and the power of God's Holy Spirit goes with you and stays with you this day and every day. Amen.